Welcome to the motherfucking relay. We're covering today's top boxing
news.
Everyone, quote unquote, everyone is running away from Terrence Crawford. What do you make of that statement?
He's great, man. He's great. I think that no one's specifically running away from him. I think no one stood up and said, I want to fight Errol Spence, or excuse me, Terrence Crawford, let's make this fight happen. It's not the time for me to do that yet. If that time comes, then I'll do that. And you got my word that if the time comes for someone to step up and fight Terrence Crawford, I will do that. At this point, everyone, you know, it is what it is. He's on one side and we're on the other. You know, no names need to be spoken. We all know what it is from a business standpoint.
So, yeah.
However, I think every fighter does know that we can, if we really want it to happen, the business can be done. So between Terrence and I, if that business wants to be done and needs to be done between him and I, we'll make it happen.
That was Helen Yee addressing the comments from one Bo Mack, who is Terrence Crawford's trainer, in regards to the situation at 147, that, you know, all these guys, none of them seem to be in any hurry to fight Terrence Crawford. Sean Porter, he addressed those comments quite plainly, that, you know what, the fight is feasible, the fight can be made, that yes, there's a business side of it, and there are guys that are on opposing sides of the street, but it is still a fight that can be made. So when you hear these comments from Sean Porter, what you need to understand is these comments completely
debunk,
destroy that entire narrative that Crawford's got to cross over to PBC to get a fight. That's not what Sean Porter's saying.
No. Nope.
That's not what he's saying. He's not saying Crawford's got to cross the street and get into a multi-fight commitment, be locked down as a PBC fighter. He's not saying none of that shit. So if he's not saying any of that shit, why are these YouTube authors, these spin doctors, these super chat panhandlers, why are they saying that? You know, it's pretty clear that these are people that have an agenda, because at no point in that interview did Sean Porter say Terrence Crawford's got to cross over to the PBC side to get a fight with me. That's not what the guy said. He addressed that there's a business side of it, that there are guys that are on opposing sides of the street. He didn't take a shot at the guy. He said he's great, all that jazz. But at no point in the juncture did he stipulate any requisites. Put simply, he said it's a situation that can happen. I tell you that I'm not against the fight. I tell you that, you know, the situation would have to be negotiated. It would have to be finagled for after the Aguidigos-Cavaliauskas fight. It being that while more people would be intrigued to see, you know, Terrence Crawford versus Sean Porter, the timing is off. There's not enough time for Sean to heal up and recuperate and get back in the ring before the year is out, with this fight with Spence having been as physical as it was. There's that to consider, but there's also what I mentioned in my previous video, that you can't trump the mandatory with a Sean Porter fight, and that's what Aguidigos-Cavaliauskas is. You know, if Sean had a belt, then you could trump the mandatory with the unification fight, but that's not what a Sean Porter fight would be, not at this point. He doesn't have a belt. So you can't circumvent your mandatory to fight Sean Porter, not without relinquishing your title. Aguidigos-Cavaliauskas has been the mandatory challenger to the WBO title since November of 2018. And when this November rolls around, that mandate, that's likely when it's going to come down. We all know how the system works. You're due to satisfy at least one mandatory challenger per year. Well, November will make a year for Aguidigos-Cavaliauskas. That's likely when that mandate is going to come down. In which case, you can't really circumvent Aguidigos-Cavaliauskas with Porter, one, because the timing is off, and two, it's not a unification fight. It's not. So it won't trump the mandatory. Aguidigos-Cavaliauskas is a necessary evil, whether you like it or not, unless you're expecting Terrence Crawford to relinquish his belt to a guy that he can beat.
Are you?
But what about after that? Moving forward, is a Porter fight feasible? I'll say in truth that if they can't get Errol Spence in the ring for the first quarter of 2020,
yeah,
Sean Porter is an option. It's an option, and it's a solid option. It is. I mean, there's genuine intrigue to see what would happen if Crawford and Sean entered the ring, it being that Sean is the most physical guy in the entire division. He's a very physical fighter, and that would be a good litmus test for Terrence Crawford's physicality at this weight. You know, it would. The thing is, though, I wonder how much credit people would actually give Terrence Crawford for fighting Sean Porter. If he fights him in the first quarter of next year, that would be saying that Sean Porter would be coming off a loss. He'd be coming off the loss to Errol Spence. So how much credit are they going to give Crawford when they see that Sean hasn't had a tune-up fight in between? This is likely going to serve as ammunition for Terrence Crawford's detractors to say that Spence softened him up, that Crawford's not fighting the same guy. I mean, we know that these guys are spin doctors, that they'll look for any stupid fucking angle to have something to say, to decorate their arguments. So I do question how much credit Crawford would get if he actually fought Sean under those circumstances, because Sean would be coming off a loss. If Terrence Crawford is going to be your first fight of 2020, okay, then it's likely you're going right from Errol into a Crawford fight.
Back to back.
I mean, I could hear these motherfuckers now trying to downplay the outcome of the fight. And we'll get into what I think that would be. We'll get into that. We'll talk about the fight mechanics of it. But yeah, I mean, that would be more or less the situation. I want to say that it's a bit premature for this conversation. I want to say this because at this time, Errol Spence himself is talking about running it back with Sean Porter. So in many ways, this proposition is very immaterial. There's not much substance to it. You know, we don't know that Crawford will end up facing Sean Porter or that Errol Spence will end up facing Sean Porter in a rematch. We don't know because we're seeing what Errol Spence is saying. He's saying he wants to run it back.
All of a sudden.
You know, and that's just as much a possibility as Crawford fighting Porter is a possibility. So in many ways, it's in the air right now. It's completely immaterial. But if we're going to address the proposition of the fight, yeah, I like the fight. I think the fight would communicate to a lot of people just how good Terrence Crawford is if they saw him in there dealing with Sean Porter. The thing is that, you know, a lot of his critics, a lot of his detractors, these are guys that have no integrity. So regardless of the outcome, what you have to realize is they're just going to work hard to try to denigrate the victory. Denigrate what they see. That what if Terrence Crawford goes in there and he has a much easier time with Sean Porter than Keith Thurman had, than Danny Garcia had, and then Errol Spence had? You know, what if it happens that way? What do you think these guys are going to do? I can tell you what they're going to do. They're going to say that Spence softened him up.
Yeah.
They're going to say that he was coming off a loss.
Yeah.
They're going to say that, you know, Spence beat the fight out of him.
Yeah.
Or he left it all in the ring in the Spence fight. That's what they're going to say. The same guys that here today are demanding that Crawford fight Sean Porter are the same guys who would denigrate the victory if that's how it happened. Oh. If Crawford were to beat him. They go from demanding that he fight the guy to shitting on the victory. That's what they would do, because I reiterate, these guys don't have no integrity. They're not proposing that he fight Sean Porter as a litmus test. That's not why they're proposing that. They're proposing that so that they could give Spence an excuse to keep stalling. That's literally the only fucking reason that you're seeing this surge of guys hounding Terrence Crawford with the name of Sean Porter. That's the only reason they're doing it. They're not doing it because they think it's going to be a great fight. They're not doing it because, you know, it's a good litmus test for Crawford's physicality as opposed to his technique. They're not doing it for none of that shit. The only reason they're doing it, the only reason they're all of a sudden demanding that fight is so that they can give Spence a green light to keep stalling, because that's what he's doing, and they're just as aware of it as me and you are.
They know.
Do you honestly believe that if Terrence Crawford went in there and went as far as knocking out Sean Porter, do you honestly believe that those same guys would give him credit for it?
Hell no.
No, of course not. Which begs the question, okay, if that's what's going on, then why are they demanding it? I reiterate, it's just so that they can give Spence an excuse to keep stalling. That's what the motivating factor is, ladies and gentlemen. That's the only reason they're doing that. You don't honestly believe that these guys who regularly flip the script and regularly change their narrative, you don't think that these guys are demanding this fight for any reason other than to give Spence a green light to keep stalling, right?
Do you?
You don't believe that. These are the guys who, before Saturday, swore up and down on a stack of Bibles that Errol Spence is going to knock out Sean Porter. He's going to kill him. He's going to flatten him, okay? These were the guys. These were the guys that thought that Sean Porter doesn't stand a chance. Doesn't have a shot in the dark against Errol Spence. That wasn't my take. You know, my take was Errol doesn't have it in him to knock out Sean Porter. This guy can't knock out a blown-up lightweight. How's he going to knock out Sean Porter? That was my take, but that wasn't their take. The same guys that are sitting here demanding that Crawford fight Sean Porter, those same guys
wrote him off.
Were the same guys who didn't think much of Sean Porter ahead of the Spence fight. So now after the fight, oh, now all of a sudden, Sean Porter's the greatest thing since sliced bread. Now all of a sudden, Sean Porter beats Terrence Crawford. That's the new narrative, okay? That's the new spin they put on things at 147. That Terrence Crawford champ has got to jump through all these hoops to get an Errol Spence fight. And, you know, I didn't see anybody asking Mikey Garcia to jump through hoops to get a Spence fight. And he's accomplished even less at 147 than Terrence Crawford has. Yet at no point in Mikey Garcia's various call-outs did I see anyone suggesting that, oh, he's got to fight Kell Brook first. He's got to fight some common opponents first. I didn't see anybody saying that. But with Crawford, you see how the narrative changes. So believe me when I say that if Crawford were to go in there and put on a career-best performance, it really wouldn't stop these guys from denigrating him. It wouldn't, because they're not demanding that fight to see the fight. They just want to give Spence an avenue to keep stalling. But what about the fight? You know, the fight itself. I mean, never mind the fanboys, the YouTube panhandlers, the sycophants, never mind them. What about the fight? What do I think would happen if you put Terrence Crawford and Sean Porter in the ring at the same time? Ladies and gentlemen, I will say that this is where Terrence Crawford's previous experiences with smaller fighters that can really move, have a low center of gravity, and know how to angle their torsos to get under and or around a fighter's jab and his sweeping hooks. This is where his experiences with the likes of a Uriotakis Gamboa, his experiences with the likes of a Felix Diaz, this is where those experiences would really service him. I will say, comparatively, that Sean Porter is a more durable fighter than those guys. He's got a better chin than a Felix Diaz, and he's got a better chin than a Uriotakis Gamboa. You know, that's what he's got on those guys.
He takes a better punch.
But what makes those fights similar is that Terrence Crawford would be a guy with a height advantage and a reach advantage. And the task before him would be controlling the room and the real estate so that he can continue to fight his fight, as opposed to being drawn into Sean's fight, like how Errol Spence was drawn into Sean's fight. I talked about it in my weekend recap video, how, you know, it became very clear early in the fight, painfully obvious, that Errol Spence's jab has been diffused, because you really can't stop this guy from getting into his desired range. He's constantly closing the gap on you, and you can do little more than engage him in what is his fight, because we all know Sean Porter is a phone booth fighter. Well, I don't think that would happen to Terrence Crawford, because it just so happens that Terrence Crawford has more experience in that area than Errol Spence had ahead of that Sean Porter fight.
How so?
In the Uriotakis Gamboa fight, in the Felix Diaz fight, Terrence Crawford was faced with a task to where he's got to be able to nail the smaller fighter coming in. Now, in the Gamboa fight, you know, back when Gamboa was undefeated, you know, he was a fresher guy. This is a fighter who's light on his feet. He's very nimble. He's got in and out game. He knows how to be elusive. Good hand speed. He's got all these things. And he brings these things to the table to help him close the gap on what is a more statuesque fighter than himself. And this is a fight where Terrence Crawford struggled. I mean, Gamboa had moments in this fight. We all know how it worked out. We all know that eventually Terrence Crawford bounced his ass off the fucking canvas like a football, you know? So there's that. And he took those experiences with a guy that has smaller dimensions and is very elusive. He took those experiences over to the Felix Diaz fight. He had those experiences with Gamboa to draw from in the Diaz fight. And in the Diaz fight, he didn't struggle at all, you know, with that guy. And it's a similar situation to where you're facing a fighter who's a smaller guy with a lower center of gravity who can really move but still has to close the gap to get to you because he's the smaller fighter. There's no way the smaller guy's going to be able to fight the fight from the outside. You're a sitting duck out there. So both a Gamboa and a Diaz and a Sean Porter, they have that same task in front of them to where they have to close the gap to fight their fight. And it is there where Crawford's previous experiences would serve him the best, that he has the kind of accuracy, the kind of sharp shooting abilities that Errol Spence didn't have, because up until that Porter fight, he was never faced with that kind of an opponent, that kind of a situation, whereas Terrence Crawford has been here at least two times already against two, count them two, Olympic gold medalists, because need I remind you, Uriotakis Gamboa, Felix Diaz, they both came from an Olympic background, and they were both Olympic gold medalists. And the underlying principle of those fights, the dynamic of those situations, is very similar to the dynamic of a Sean Porter situation, because he's got to get within his desired range the same way they did. And what's required, what would be required of Crawford, is to fight on the fly. But not just fighting on the fly for sake of fighting on the fly, not just sticking and moving, but being accurate, being a sharpshooter, catching the guy with jabs over the top as he's trying to come in, walking him into shots like lead uppercut. You know what kind of fight Sean Porter wants to fight. You know where he needs to be to fight that fight. And in that way, you can anticipate his movements. This is something that Terrence Crawford has had to do in the past, and it's likely what he would do with Sean Porter. My prediction for such a fight, if it were to ever to come into fruition, though I'm not sure it will, but if it were to, if it does, my prediction is that Terrence Crawford would stop Sean Porter, and he'd stop him late. Sean Porter, I reiterate, is a more durable guy than a Yuriorkis Gamboa. He's a more durable guy than a Felix Diaz. So it would be one of the more physically taxing fights that Terrence Crawford will have been in. But he's got the kind of accuracy, the kind of mobility, the switch hitting, that he can attack Sean Porter from different angles, even whilst on the fly. He can attack him as an orthodox fighter or a southpaw. Whatever works and whatever is needed in the moment. Because we all know, Terrence Crawford adapts on the go. And Terrence Crawford, unlike Errol Spence, he doesn't need to be at a particular range throwing a particular set of punches to generate power. Terrence Crawford generates as much power with his straight punches as he does with his bent arm punches, with his hooks. He doesn't need to be in a particular range to fire off power shots. Whereas in the case of Errol Spence, Errol's power in the phone booth isn't what it is mid-range to outside. Mid-range to outside, Errol Spence generates very good power. But when he's in that phone booth, his work is being smothered. Terrence Crawford, on the other hand, he can throw bent on punches on the inside or straight shots from the outside, and they all got a lot of mustard on them.
I'll say that I think the fight would test Crawford's physicality. I mean, if it really were going to be a litmus test for something, it would be that. It would be Crawford's condition, having to maintain that pace with Sean Porter, who we all know is a high-octane, high-volume puncher. If there's anything that would be tested in that fight, when it comes to Crawford, it would be his physicality. But accuracy, being a sniper, being a sharpshooter, that's what would win him the fight. And I've no doubts that's a fight he would win. How necessary the fight is? Well, that depends on who you ask. I'm not opposed to the fight. I don't think it's necessary. I don't think it should be a requisite. But if it came on the television, yeah, I'd certainly fucking watch it. If it were on pay-per-view, yeah, I'd certainly order it. But is it necessary? No, it's not necessary in the least bit, because I reiterate, you guys weren't asking Mikey Garcia to earn an Errol Spence fight. You were perfectly okay with a guy who did absolutely nothing at 147 getting to challenge Spence for his IBF title. You guys were okay with that. So where do you come from with this shit that Crawford's got to jump through hoops when he's accomplished more as a welterweight more than Mikey Garcia, but all of a sudden you got to jump through hoops for a Spence fight? I don't fucking think so. I don't think, you know, Crawford versus Porter is a bad fight. I don't.
It's a great fight.
But if the point and purpose of the fight, if what the narrative has become is that Crawford should fight Porter so that he can get some respect, just look at where that's coming from, look at who's saying it, and ask yourself, do you think that these guys are going to give Terrence Crawford if he fights Sean Porter?
Going to get him respect?
Fuck no! That's not why they're proposing that.
Not at all.
So don't kid yourself. Yeah. Terrence Crawford can beat Sean Porter, of course he can, and he can do it, he'd fuck around, do it in spectacular fashion. But would it change anything? No, it wouldn't.